Hi everyone, welcome to our lecture. Today we'll finish the second part of the introduction to computers, programs, and Java. And we will get into elementary programming in Java. The class will be followed by the lab, like usual. Today we'll basically do lab 2, which starts by debugging the ChangeMaker program and then implementing several programs in Java, including the temperature conversion from Celsius to Fahrenheit. So let's start with the lecture for today. So here is where we stopped last class. Basically, I was telling you that in order to implement programs with Java, you need to have the Java development kit, which basically comes with the Java compiler and the JVM. In addition, there are a few more tools that basically allow you to compile into bytecode, textual bytecode, so you can actually inspect the code that is resulted from the compiler. There is a shell that comes since version Java 12 with Java. It's similar to the shell that comes with Python. It's basically a Java interpreter that allows you to define methods and test them separately in the shell. Okay. So there are different versions of Java that you can download for JDK. The standard edition is the one that we are using in this class because we develop client-side standalone applications. There are also J2EE, the Java Enterprise Edition, which basically is for developing server-side applications, such as Java servlets and Java server pages. These are also available in the standard edition, but you can basically download the jars and use them as part of the Java standard edition. Our textbook uses the standard edition, therefore that's what we are using for this class. There is also a micro edition, which was used for developing applications for mobile devices. So let's start with a simple Java program. So this is the welcome to Java program that you have seen in the first lecture. It basically has two lines of commands. These are standard commands in programming languages. They started in C, two forward slashes, and then the entire line after those two characters is a comment. You can basically put anything that will be ignored by the compiler. Then you define a class. This is a public, it's a modifier that basically states that this is a class that can be used from any other place in any other package. Then the keyword class that states that this is a class. There are a set of reserved words in Java called keywords. They cannot be used as names or variables or for any other reason, but basically to define objects. So public is such a keyword, is a modifier. It defines that the class is public, is not private or protected. Class is a keyword used to define classes. You also see below static. Static is a keyword that specifies that this method is a method that belongs to the class, not to object instances of that class. Void is a type. In fact, it states that this method doesn't return anything. That's basically, this method doesn't return anything. So you can use basically the return statement with no argument whatsoever. Then you have string. It's not a keyword, it's actually a type, but it is part of the Java lang package. So it basically can only be used for defining strings. It's loaded by default in the Java core when you start the JVM. Then we have args, which is a name. We have open close parentheses stating that this is an array. An array is a list of elements of the type string. Then we have a statement, and this statement is in the system class, the out field and the method println. And basically it has an argument stating that this returns welcome to Java. It basically calls that method println to print welcome to Java in the command prompt. Every statement in Java ends with semicolon. You will see this in a couple of minutes. Then we have the close curly brace. Basically, it's a close brace for the block that started, this method block that started for the main method. And then another one for closing the main class, the public class welcome. So one thing that for you to know about Java is that Java doesn't consider indentations or white space at all. In fact, the first thing that is done when a class is compiled, white spaces are deleted from the entire program. And by white spaces, I mean new line characters, tabs, or spaces, any kind of white spaces. So Java doesn't rely on the indentation. You can put the entire program in one line, or you can indent these methods in any way you want. It's a standard good practice to basically indent methods within a class and statements within a method, but this is not a requirement. So again, if you want to execute this program and see how it works, you basically create a new class called welcome. And someone asked if you can use IntelliJ or other IDEs. You can use any IDE that you want. I actually have several on my computer, but I will use Eclipse for you because it's the simplest that one basically can start with. And this is CSE 160, so we basically want to be as simple as possible at this level. So again, if you want to create for that welcome class a new class, and you can add by default the public main method, so you don't have to write it. And then we have that statement. So let's delete this comment and write system.out. Welcome to Java. And as I said, every statement ends with semicolon. Now, so this is how you run a Java program. If you want to debug it, you can put a breakpoint. And again, you can click on this bug looking button and it will open a separate perspective called the debugging perspective. And in this debugging perspective, you can run programs line by line and see the output of every line. Okay. And you can always go back to the Java perspective when you are done. So this is basically your first Java program. It just prints welcome to Java, nothing else. There is one statement within a method, within a public class. So what actually happens internally? We basically created that source code, which is a pure text file. You can open it with Notepad, or you can open it with Emacs or Vim, any kind of editor. You create and modify the source code. The source code is basically a file saved on the disk with the same name with the public class name. Then you can compile the source code with Java C and the name of that file. The output will be Java bytecode, which if you compile that Java bytecode with a textual assembler, it will basically generate what you currently see here, something saying that these are step-by-step assembly instructions for the JVM. Once you compiled it and there were no compilation errors, you can continue to run it. And you can run it with the Java JVM command. So that's Java and welcome, the name of the class, and you see the result. Usually development has several steps and iterations. So if you don't like the result or you want to add more stuff to the result, you can basically return back to create and modify again the source code. So there are two types of errors that can exist in Java. One are compilation errors. Compilation errors are when you basically made a syntax error, usually syntax errors, but they are not only syntax errors, there are also things that can be checked at compile time, like for instance, the correct type of objects. So usually this is called static analysis. If the program can be statically analyzed, basically that It has every single statement, the correct syntax. It types of expressions are correct with respect to the type of the variables that were defined. Those kind of things can be checked by the compiler, and if everything is correct, it continues. If not, you basically need to modify the source code. No class file is produced if there were an error, if there was an error. Similarly, there are runtime errors. Runtime errors are basically those errors that appear at runtime. They are not because of some compilation mistake or a typo. They are because some illegal operation happened. Like, for instance, you are reading from a file on the hard drive, and this is a USB hard drive, and somebody pulls out the USB drive. This is a runtime error. Nobody could have prevented it when they wrote the program, and basically the program runs incorrectly. There are actually two types of runtime errors. There are runtime errors that basically crash the program, and then there are those errors that actually give you incorrect result, or what we call bugs, logical errors. Logical errors are basically when you made some mistake in the computation and return the incorrect value. Like, for instance, you want to check that a number is between 1 and 100, and instead of making the correct statements to check that range, you check that the number is between 1 and 50. So for numbers greater than 50, you would have some error result. You will say that it's not in the set, but it is. So there are actually three types of errors that appear in Java: compilation errors, runtime errors that crash the program, and logical errors when maybe no crash happens, but you get the incorrect result and thus resulted from the correctness of your program. Now, you can run the same program from command line. So for instance, I can go to, let me see what's the name of my user spaces, Eclipse workspace. And here I have CSC 160 and I have the SRC where I have CSC 160 as a package, and I have the welcome program. So basically I need to compile the program. Java C will compile the program, and then I can run the program from command line. Many cases you will basically, in many cases, in this case it actually says could not find or load the class. Okay, that's a good thing. So I will show you why that error appears. It's because my class path variables are not set correctly. Okay, I will show you in a couple of minutes. So basically this is how you run a program from the command line. In many cases, you have to run programs from the command line. Either that you basically don't have a user interface for that computer, like a server does not have usually a window a manager. You will basically have to write everything from command line in some shell, in some command line interface. Now, in order to run and compile Java from the command window, you need to set a bunch of important variables. So the first variable is actually the variable that adds the executable files. Like, for instance, in this case, we want to add the path to the executable Java C and Java programs, those that are used for basically compiling the program, to your path environment variable. This path environment variable is basically the list of all the paths where executables are located. So when you run something in command line on your computer, it looks for executables with that name in a long path of locations. So basically, it could be your Windows program files. It could be your location where Java is located and so on. So basically, the path is this environment variable that tells the operating system where everything is that can be executed. On Windows, it's quite easy to find where that path is. You can actually open any Windows Explorer, go to this PC, basically your machine is one of the many elements that are folders that are available in your Windows file manager, click right and go to properties. Okay. This is recorded so you can actually try it yourself if you have a Windows computer. Then you have to click on advanced settings, then environment variables. And in environment variables, there are actually two paths. One is for the user variables for the current user. So for instance, for me, or those that are shared between all the users of this machine. It doesn't matter in which one you put the Java location. It basically, either one is a correct location where you can add that variable, that location. In my case, let me actually see, it's actually in the user environment variables for the user. You can see I have C program files, Java, JDK 1.8.0, 201 bin. That's the location where that specific Java is. And usually the way to find it is to see where Java was installed on your machine. So in my case, that's the place where Java was installed when I actually run the installer for JDK, and that's where I find all of these executables. You can actually see there is Java C, there is jar, which basically makes a zip-like archive of your entire project, and there are many other executables. Okay, so you have to find that location. Under the bin directory are actually the executables that you are interested in, and you can go one folder up to see what else is available there. You can see the Java runtime environment, any kind of jars that are included, and header files and other libraries. These libraries are actually important if you want to run from command line, like I basically tried to do before. And this actually also need to be added to a different variable if you try to run from command line a program called classPath. So classPath is another environment variable similar to path, which basically is the location of all of the classes that can be used in Java. So in order to actually run that program that I had before, I must have all of the jars that are, that come with Java when Java is installed for the first time on your computer, to this variable, to this environment variable classPath. Once this is done, so I also have classPath on my machine. I can actually show it to you. Let me close this. And I have classPath. I actually don't see the classPath. So that's why that Java program didn't work, because I actually didn't set the classPath to contain the locations of all of the Java files. I will do this after I actually do the lecture before the lab, because that's probably the better time to do this setup of variables. In your case, probably all the programs that you are running in this class will be in Eclipse. So I will do this after the lecture, so it's easier for you to see the lecture and then see how this classPath is set. In Eclipse, it's quite easy. You basically have two ways to run a program. One is for that welcome.java to run it from the run button that you see up here, or you click right on that program and run as Java application. And that's basically running that program. If you want to trace it, I already showed you that you can put the breakpoint within the program, and then you execute it line by line and see the result in the console or the command prompt. Okay. Now, let me tell you about the syntax of a Java program. So we will cover today comments, reserved words, modifiers, which are actually a subset of the reserved words, statements in Java, basically the general statements about statements that they all end with semicolons. They are within blocks, and these blocks can be class blocks, or they can be method blocks or inner blocks. Then we have within those methods, then we have classes. You can define multiple classes in a file as long as only one of them is public. And the name of the file is the name of that public class. Then methods are basically like functions in mathematics, sinus, cosinus. Those are basically names for mathematical functions that will be executed when you invoke them with parameters, like give me sinus of 90 degrees. And basically it's a function, takes a value in a domain and returns a value in a codomain. One of the methods that is most important to us is the main method. So the main method is the main entrance point to your program when you try to run it. So the statements in the main method will be executed from top to bottom in a sequence. So we'll start with comments. There are three types of comments in Java. The first one that you saw in that program is called a line comment. Basically, it's preceded by two forward slashes, and everything that comes after those forward slashes is ignored by the compiler. Okay. So if I go back to my Eclipse, I can put as many comments as I would like. I can have a line comment here, something. Maybe I can put a line comment at the end of this line, something else. These are basically all ignored by Java because you are basically, usually you put some kind of message, like this is the main method, something to help you later, or to help another programmer that sees this code later to know what's happening in that specific code. And here you can basically put, I'm printing something, okay? Really, they are messages left within the code for the future. No matter if it's you after a while and you come and you forgot what you did, or it's another programmer that you work with and you basically want to see the messages. Okay. It's again, very important to be very clear, polite, and actually say what exactly is there and what's happening. I can tell you that I worked in a big company, Mercedes, and I've seen all kinds of comments that were completely off the requirements. Like for instance, sometimes in foreign languages, it doesn't help anyone else but you if you leave a comment in a different language. No, sometimes I made mistakes. I was leaving basically messages within the program, and sometimes it was the wrong messages. Basically, I was trying to analyze somebody else's program, and my understanding was different than that person's. Paragraph comments. So a paragraph comment is enclosed within forward slash star and star forward slash, and everything contained within those is ignored again by the compiler. So for instance, I want something more here stating what am I doing in this program. So this is a paragraph comment. These inner stars are really not needed. You can basically put here, this is ignored by the compiler. So the difference between line comments is a line comment starts at the beginning of these forward two forward slashes and ends the moment that we have a new line. So that's why the next statement is actually a correct statement, is not commented out. This one basically says anything between the beginning and the end of the paragraph comment is ignored. So here you can have as many lines as you want. This can be even in, can start on the previous paragraph. It still doesn't matter anything within those two, including new lines or anything else is going to be ignored by the compiler, okay? And usually you can use something like that when you want to comment out some more code. Maybe somebody wrote some more code and you basically comment it out. It will not be executed when you run that program. It will only execute this one statement that we had before. So that's a paragraph comment. There is another type of paragraph comment called Java doc comments. They start with \\ So usually you see them before methods. So like this method here, we use a paragraph comment, okay? And it usually specifies like what is the goal of that method. Like this method has arguments that are, the parameters are the arguments. Also is collected out by the Java doc. So Java doc is actually a directive which generates Java doc. It generates a documentation for your project. So for instance, by clicking this and stating, I want to generate documentation for this entire project. Java.doc command, I have to set up the Java.doc command for the first time. Let's set it up. So I have to find the Java doc. You only have to do this first time that you run Java doc. In, and I have Java doc. So let me show you what it looks like. So do you want to generate? Yeah, put it whenever you want. And now I have a documentation that comes with my program. And welcome.html, it's an HTML. I can open it with the web browser. And it basically shows that this is the class welcome. And there is the constructor, default constructor welcome, and it contains only the main method. So what basically these Java doc comments do, they basically are those strings that you see within the descriptions of methods in Java doc. So really what Java doc is a way to comment and actually generate the documentation with these comments when you actually want to see only the signatures of every single method in the program. This set of all the methods that are available for every class is also called the API. Application interface, programming interface. So basically it's just a different type of comment that is collected for documentation. Any questions? I haven't heard anyone, so I'm
just can I...
Go ahead, ask a question.
Okay. Does the other person want to go first? Okay. You know how you mentioned jar files? Is that how we're supposed to submit the homework for, let's say, lab number one? I know we're supposed to submit two .java files, like hello world and changemaker. So how are we supposed to submit it in a zip? I don't know.
You can actually either submit them one by one. So basically when you submit an assignment, you can actually browse for as many files as you want. So you can basically
in that case 2.java files, right?
Yeah. So then you would attach the two Java files. You can also attach a zip of all the Java files together. Either way is fine for the lab.
Oh, also sorry, one more thing. You know how in Eclipse they put the package on the first line of code? Should we delete it? Because then you wouldn't be able to run it, I think. Like the package CSC 160.
Yes. So one thing about, when I created this, I created it within a package CSC 160. But I could have just created a similar file with no package, like in the default package. That's what I would like, because that way I basically, you can test and you make sure that everything works, but I don't have to deal with the package. Now, the truth is that I can go and actually really erase that package with a simple script that looks for package at the beginning of the file. And if this such package, it deletes that line or comments it out. Either way is fine with me. Labs are really for practicing, nothing else. As I said in the last lecture, if you submit only one of the classes that was required in that lab, that's fine. Especially at the beginning, we haven't covered anything yet. So if you submit in this lab just the change maker, that's good enough. Because really, I want you to just be able to run things at the beginning. And then later this semester, you will be able to solve like 5 problems per lab. But for the moment, if you just submit one of them and you don't worry about the package name and things like that, basically I will write my testing scripts to eliminate them. Okay. Any other questions? Or did that solve your question?
Yeah, it did, thanks.
Welcome. Okay, who else wanted to ask a question? Is lab attendance required? I don't take any lab attendance. In fact, you can watch the lab afterwards. I believe that in recordings, I put also the lab. So lab attendance is not required. Submitting the lab in Blackboard is required for credit. Okay, good.
Oh, could I actually ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
So for the directory for ClassPath, I kind of missed that. I was trying to follow along. So I set the directory for the actual path, and I was trying to set it for the class path, but I was kind of confused on what to set that for, like the
command line. Yeah, so actually I had the same problem when I was trying to run this. So what I recommended is that we leave this for after the lecture.
Oh, okay.
Okay. This way we can do the lecture and then we can fix this, not only for you, but for me too. Okay, good. Okay, so let's return back to the lecture. So those are comments. Next, keywords. So keywords are reserved words. They basically have a specific meaning to the compiler, and they cannot be used for any other purpose in the program. Every single programming language has some keywords, something that defines things, and you cannot use it for a variable name or a method name and so on. For instance, the first example I can give you in that program that we wrote, class. The word after class is expected to be the name of the class. It cannot be used for any other reason. You can't define a variable whose name is class. They are basically reserved words with specified meaning. It's a relatively finite set, but there are quite a lot of these words. Some of them are used for types, like for instance, Boolean, car. These are types in Java. Then some of them are actually used for modifiers for stating the properties of classes or methods or data fields. Like for instance, abstract states that a class is abstract, meaning that you can't instantiate objects out of that class. It's only used to group together all the properties of subclasses of that class. And so on. Basically, there are many keywords. You don't need to remember them. I will actually cover slowly most of them. So we will see what's null used for is basically a reference that was never initialized to an object in memory. Package you have already seen. Private is similar to public, is for defining what data is not available in other packages or other classes. Return is used to, it's a return statement, is used to return a value from a method, and so on. So they are used for different reasons, but they need to be standardized and no one else uses them, but for the reason why they were defined, okay? So similarly, throw is for throwing exceptions. Synchronized is for defining that the method is basically there is a critical space where only one thread can run at one moment. So it basically locks from other threads, from other processes that run in parallel. Volatile is for stating that a data field is not saved when you try to save an object into a binary, to serialize an object into binary. A while is a statement. It's like a for loop, but basically is for defining while loops. Okay. So let's start with the first set of keywords. And this set of keywords are called modifiers. They specify the properties of data, methods, and classes. And you have seen a few of them, public, static, okay? The meaning of data that is defined to be public is that data or method or class can be accessed by other programs. Private means that can only be accessed by the current program, nothing else, by only the current class can use it, okay?
Professor?
Go ahead.
So if, for example, I had two different classes in the same Java, in the same folder.
File or folder?
Folder.
Okay.
So like I had Hello CSC 160 and Welcome in the same folder, for example.
Like in the same package, like this is a folder, CSC 160, and it has two files in it.
Right. So if I declared a public variable in one of those, does that mean that it would be able to be accessed in the other Java file? In
exactly.
Other
class?
Okay. Yep.
So here I can define public static p integer p equal with 2 and save it. And then we go to welcome and we print out hello CSC 160.p. So this is fine, and it will print 2 because that was the value of p. Now, if I go here and I define this instead of public as private, I save it. This one. Now, this one basically says the field hello CSC 160p is not visible.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Another keyword that I used here when I defined that was static. So static basically stated that this data field is a property of the class itself. It's not a property of objects of the type hello CSC 160. Because if this would have been non-static, I can only use it if I create objects of the type hello CSC 160. So I use hello CSC 160 as basically a pattern. This is a new object of the type hello CSC 160. You can use as many such objects as you want. You can create object 1, object 2, object 3. And each one of them has a different P because this is basically it's a variable that belongs to each one of them. So for instance, o.p can be set to 3. o2.p can be set to 4. And that's fine. Basically, I have each object has its own state and its own set of inner variables. So that's the difference between static. Static basically assigns it to the class itself. Non-static assigns it to every single object instance of that specific class. But we will talk more about this later, but I just wanted to show you that static is also a modifier. It's a modifier that states that the property belongs to the class itself. And there is only one for all of the objects of that class. Okay, statements. So a statement is basically an action or a sequence of actions that is executed in that sequential execution of steps in an algorithm. So for instance, system.out.println welcome to Java, it's a statement that prints the greeting welcome to Java. You can have multiple such statements in a method. In Java, there is a requirement that every statement ends with semicolon. So this is different than other programming languages, like in Python, because indentation is used for stating which is each individual statement. Basically, you don't need to end the statement with semicolon because you know that the next statement is either indented within or at the same level, meaning that it's a different statement. Blocks. Again, as different than Python, in Python, you basically define a method, and then the statements within that method are indented with one tab or four spaces within that method. Okay, four spaces is the standard for Python 3, and it basically states that these are statements within that method. Java doesn't have such a requirement. In Java, the methods that are in a class or the statements that are in a method are enclosed within a block. And the block starts with open curly brace and it ends with closed curly brace. And the spacing and the indentation doesn't matter. You can have a program that everything is aligned at column zero or any kind of weird alignment, but it really doesn't matter. It's just a matter of nice programming. Because Java doesn't look at the indentation, it actually uses these curly braces for seeing what is in every single block. Okay, so a block is a way to group all the components of a method or of a class of a program. And even within methods themselves, you can have blocks. So if I want here, I can add a block and have some other statements inside here. Like for instance, I have some system.out.println, something else. Really, this is just an inner block. It basically says there is something else defined here. You can have multiple statements. You can redefine or define new variables. So I can define another variable of four, let's say. One thing about blocks is that variables are alive. They can be used between the place where they were defined up to the end of the block in which those variables were defined. Okay, so in the case of O4 that I defined here, at the end of this block, the block that O4 was defined in, O4 disappears. So if somebody wants to use O4 for any reason whatsoever, it will basically be told that there is no O4 because that O4 is already garbage collected. It will give me options. Do you want to create a new variable O4? Because the O4 was only available between where it was defined up to the end of the block of that block in which it was defined. So this is called static scoping. It basically defines that a variable is available between the point that it was defined up to the end of the block. Okay. So those are blocks. They basically let you group statements and methods within a class. Now, there are two different styles for defining blocks. And one style is called end of line style, which basically means that when you want to open a new block, like for instance, the block that contains the methods for the class test, you put the curly brace at the end of that line, and then you start indenting the rest of the code until the end of the block, one tab or some number of spaces to the right. But really, is the fact is that we open blocks at the end of whatever is the place where we want to define that block. There is another style which you will see older programmers using, in which you basically put these curly braces, the opening the block, and the either for classes or for methods at the same line where you close them. So basically you can see that is a little bit, the end of line style is more concise. You have less number of lines as opposed that to a new next line style, which is a little bit more spacious. But I personally, because we are using indentation anyway, I see no reason to put these parentheses here and here instead of putting them at the end of the previous line. So we use, most of us, we use end of line style, and I would highly recommend that you use it too. It's something that if you work in a group, everybody has to agree to a common style. So I was telling you earlier that with Java Doc, you collect all of the methods that are available in the class. And that set of methods available in the class, only the signatures, like how are the methods called and what are the arguments and what's the return type. That is called the application programming interface. It's basically the interface, the set of methods that you can invoke for that specific class. And it's kind of like a library. It tells you like a table of contents in a textbook. It tells you what exactly is in every chapter. Everything is independent and you know to go directly to that page to actually look at that method if you are interested in it. Okay. In Java, this API is the set of all the names available to you as a programmer. And these names can be names of variables, names of classes, names of methods, and they come from two sources. Those that you define, like for instance, hello, and the variable p that I was showing you earlier, those are my names. I gave names to my variable, to my class, to my method, and so on. Or they may be the ones that are available in Java from somebody else, either that you imported that package or that class, or they are in Java lang. The default set that comes into Java and is available to you right at the beginning. Okay. So what exactly are names? Names are basically everything that you define, or data, or commands, methods. And the reason why you give it a name is because you need it later. So you define a variable somewhere in the code, my variable, you assign it 5, and someone later, you basically use it to increment it with 1 or to print it. That's why you use a name. You give a name to something like an alias, and now you can refer to it. You can basically use that name to grab it, to assign some other value to it. And there are a bunch of rules for names in Java. Names should contain letters, numbers, and underscore. Dollar sign is also allowed, but is actually for a special purpose. If you define in a class, like for instance, this welcome class that we had before, you define an inner class. So you also define here class blah. Okay. So in fact, when you compile this, it will basically, it will have a welcome dollar sign blah. So basically now you know that there is an inner class within the outer class. There is an outer class and there is an inner class within that outer class. That's when dollar is used. It's for a special purpose to break this class hierarchy for a single file when you basically compile a file that contains class, multiple classes. Now, another rule, so basically you should not use dollar sign. You should use letters, numbers, and underscore. Okay. You cannot begin with a digit. So basically you can call your variables, my variable, my underscore variable. You cannot call your variable for my variable. You can't begin a variable in Java or a name with a digit. Java is case sensitive, which is mostly the case with all programming languages that I'm aware of. I've never actually seen a programming language, and I must tell you, I've basically learned maybe 100 programming languages in my days. You will also, basically, you will see how dynamic programming languages are, and you basically have to learn lots of different programming languages to be able to progress in computer science. Moreover, in most cases, languages change. Also, they became obsolete. So languages that I learned that became obsolete were Fox, Ruffle, Haskell. Haskell, maybe it has some uses, and but not many, and so on. There are many different languages that they were popular at some point, but then they basically disappeared. Okay. But in all of the languages that I learned, they were all case sensitive. There is one language that now I realize that is not case sensitive, which is SQL. It's a language for querying databases. You can everything, names and statements can be uppercase, lowercase, mixed in any way you want, capitalized and so on. So, but Java is a case sensitive language in which if you use a word with some case, uppercase, lowercase for any single character, you have to use it in the same way to identify the same object. So for instance, as good examples, legal examples of identifiers, these are legal examples. My variable contains only letters, starts with a letter. Some letters are uppercase. My underscore class is also fine. It contains an underscore. It's a variable. My for variable is also correct. You have a digit in it, but that's fine as long as it doesn't start with a digit. Yes, you can start with underscore. That's the only thing that you can use, and you can define variables and methods starting with underscore. Okay. Okay. Should you use variables started with lowercase letter? That's my next point. Variables and methods usually start with lowercase letters. And there are also some other statements that basically classes start with uppercase letters. Variables and class identifiers usually should be nouns. So when you define person or you define radius for variables, they are nouns. Methods should be verbs, like for instance, is string, or it's basically it's a verb or a verb phrase, something to basically execute something like an action. That's what methods usually do, execute an action, return a value. The camel case notation is quite useful when you have multiple words in an identifier. In order to easily make for somebody to read what that identifier is, you capitalize every new word in the identifier. So my variable, my class, you can see that because it's a class, it starts with uppercase letter, but still it's two words concatenated together. You capitalize every word. Okay. Although it's legal, do not begin again with underscore. In Python, it has a specific meaning that is private data. And it's actually inherited from older programming languages. For instance, in Fortran, there were no modifiers. So you didn't know what is public and what's private and what is constant. So people would start using all kinds of standards that if you capitalize every letter in a word, that's a constant. Similarly for underscore, it kind of tells you that it's a private data. Okay. Always use descriptive names, linked list. If you have a list linked of elements together, compare to when you write a method that compares the current object with some other object, area, pi, like for this constant radius, always use names that mean to you and to somebody else the same thing, because you can write the same program using LL, city, or A is equal with P, multiply with R, multiply with R, or even use X for the radius, but then you actually need to put more energy to understand what the program was about when you read the program. Any questions? Okay, so let's see if there are any questions in the chat. Okay, there are a few questions like what is a class? Is there any particular reason why it's not a convention? It is a convention, camel case, or it's a convention for Java. Ah, is there any preference between camel case or words concatenated with underscore? Not in Java. In Java, there is no convention. I think it's whatever it's easier for someone to use. You will see that in my case, I think I prefer the underscore instead of the camel case. What does starting a variable name with an underscore represent? It's just a variable in Java. The fact that some words that start with underscore are supposed to be private are just a convention. They don't have any strict meaning. Okay, good. Okay, so let's return back to the program. So programming errors can be of three types. Syntax errors, also called compiler errors, that are detected by the compiler. Runtime errors, which cause the program to abort, crash, usually. If you have an operation that normally is correct, like integer divided with integer is fine. But when the denominator is zero, you have division with zero, which gives you infinity as the result, which can't be represented. And that will basically crash the program. So you read two integers, you don't know what it is in them before you actually execute the division. That will actually, the division itself will generate a runtime error, a crash. Logical errors are basically bugs. Somebody made a mistake in the workflow of the program, and the program doesn't crash, but it actually produces erroneous results. So syntax errors are basically those that have some kind of syntax error in the program. Like for instance, you are assigning to I 30, but I is not defined. It doesn't have a type. So in Java, this is going to be a compiler error because before you can assign to a variable something, that variable has to be given some space. And that space is of a specific size defined by the type of that variable. And since the variable doesn't have a type, in Java, basically, this will be a syntax error. The program will refuse to compile because you don't have a type for that variable. A runtime error is when you basically execute some syntactically correct operation, like integer divided with integer is fine syntactically. However, when you try to execute 1 divided by 0, it gives you infinity, which can be represented. So this is basically a runtime error that if you try to do such a thing in Java, so even as a statement, 1 divided by 0, it basically, let's assign it to something, int I is equal I 1 divided by 0. It basically crashes and it tells you, oh, it's arithmetic exception, division by 0. Similarly, in other cases, you call a method with parameters of the type of the arguments of that method, but something is not accepted by that method, like the second parameter cannot be zero. That method throws an exception telling you that this is a runtime error, you can't execute it. Finally, the most important errors that you should understand are logic errors. So these are errors caused by the program that you wrote. So let's actually go over this simple program. I have a class show logic error. So this is just a class in Java is a program. Somebody asked again, what's a class? A class is a program in Java. It basically, any program in Java is a class, okay? So we have a program called show logic error with a main method, which defines a scanner. A scanner is a reader. You can read from the standard input system.in. So you define a scanner, it's an object that lets you now read integers or any other types. You read an integer in number, and then you check if you print out that the number is between 1 and 100 inclusively, and then you do the comparison. Is 1 less than that number that was read? and the number is less than 100. But there is a error here. For instance, for if you entered 1 or 100, this program will tell you false, because either the first argument of this conjunction, this is conjunction, the double ampersand sign. So this basically says it's either the first one is false or the second one is false. So the problem in this program is that it ends fine, but the you get a wrong result for certain inputs. That's a logic error. It's basically a bug that something in the program didn't return the correct result. Usually they are the hardest to find errors because it's not a syntax error. It's not something that causes the program to exit. And because usually when the program exits, it even tells you in line 6. So this is the line where the program crashed, okay? This case, it doesn't crash. It just, when you actually try it on 1 and 100, it says false, but in fact, it should say true. So in order to find such bugs, usually we have three different ways. One is to hand trace the program. We look at the program and we think line by line, what is wrong here, okay? That's basically hand tracing the program. We can actually start with some input, let's say, consider I is 0 and start to see what happens every line, but it's only a mental process. So that's not usually what we try to do. Or we insert print statements. They are very powerful. You can put a print statement wherever you want in the program and see what's the value when it cross, when it actually executes that specific point. So instead of basically see that there is an error, I can actually put a print statement to print I, maybe here. In this case, it will still be an error, but let's say that it was 1/2 and I print I here to see what's the I in that case. So insert print statements wherever you think that they are necessary. And the last case is that you put breakpoints. So that's the debugger utility that you should learn as soon as possible if you haven't learned it yet. Okay. So the debugger is basically a feature in the IDE, in the integrated development environment, that is Eclipse and other, where you can set a breakpoint. So a breakpoint you can set by double clicking on the side of the program, and that there is a breakpoint now that I created there. Let me take a bigger program. Like this one, I can put a breakpoint here, a breakpoint here, and so on. Basically, it's you set a breakpoint where the program will stop when you started with the debugger. Then you start executing the statements from that point where it stopped one by one. So execute the statements one by one, single statements at a time. If you have a method invocation, so here, let's say that this was in some method and I call that method. So let me actually take it out. So here we can define public static void m that takes no parameters and it has that code. And here I invoke m. So when I put a breakpoint to M here, let's remove the other ones, disable and disable. I have two options, either step into the method so I can execute one statement of at a time in the method M that I defined, or step over the method. That means execute this entire block at once. That's exactly what this is, trace into goes in, step over, just steps over the method. So I had an error somewhere here. Let's delete this line. So now in this M, I have a breakpoint. Let's start the debugger. So I have two options. One is step into, which basically goes into the method and now executes one statement at a time, and I return back out of the method. The other one, let's restart the debugger. So now perspective, restart the debugger. Is I can step over the method. So that method does its job. I basically executed everything from that method. I didn't have to go into and execute the statements there one by one. So that's basically what you can do with the debugger. So it speeds up your debugging. You don't need to put extra breakpoints. You can basically put the breakpoints wherever they are necessary, step over. One other thing that you can see is that it displays all the variables that were created. So these were all variables that were created. So you have a way to display the variables. They are in the variables tab. Then you can display the call stack and you can modify the variables and then continue the execution. So you have a variable. I didn't have an integer in that program, but let's say that you want to see what happens if I is set to 5. You just change the value of I and you continue the statements to see what happens if it's 5. So the following slides only are showing these different parts of debugging. So you put a breakpoint, like I set one here, you start the debugger, and then you have step into, step over, and step out. Step out, if you are in a method somewhere in the middle, you can execute the rest of the statement. So you step out, you basically finish the current method and you go to the parent. That's what step out does. So that's all about basically debugging. And we actually spent quite a lot of time on debugging. So we don't have that much time to get into elementary programming. We only have 8 minutes. Actually, no, that's not true. We have 13 minutes left. So let me actually get a little bit into this. Let's stop the recording so we can create a different recording for elementary programming.